and Skills Committee in 2017, and can I please remind everyone, including myself, present to turn their mobile phones and other devices onto silent for the duration of this meeting. The first item of business is a decision on whether to take item 3 on the agenda in private, which is consideration of the work programme up to the summer recess. Have we agreed?
Yep.
Thank you. Agenda item 2 is an evidence session with Education Scotland on its response to the committee's report on the performance and role of key educational skills bodies. I welcome to the meeting Dr. Bill Maxwell, Chief Executive, Alan Armstrong, Strategic Director, and Alastair Delaney, Chief Operating Officer of Education Scotland. And I understand that Dr. Maxwell wishes to make a short opening statement. Dr. Maxwell.
We welcome very much this opportunity to discuss the work of Education Scotland further with the committee. We have given detailed consideration to the report that the committee published in January on the performance and role of the national education bodies, and can I start by saying that we are committed to taking its conclusions and its recommendations fully into account as we plan to increase our impact and effectiveness in the years ahead. We provided a response to the committee's report, and I'm sure that there are areas of the response that you'll want to explore further today, but I thought it may be helpful for me to open the session by illustrating how we're continuing to develop the range of our work, and to do this just by picking out 3 different pieces of work from our current activities which have come to fruition since our last appearance in front of the committee. They illustrate 3 distinct but complementary aspects of the role and functions that we undertake to promote improvement in the education system. Firstly, in our curricular and pedagogical support role, we're taking forward a strong programme of activity to help local authorities and their teachers improve their understanding of standards within the new curriculum, particularly in the broad general education. That's involved production of the well-received new benchmarks for CFE levels across the curriculum, and equally, if not more importantly, a programme of support for the use of these benchmarks and the moderation of standards across teachers and across schools. We now have a team of development officers working directly with designated local authority officers to build capacity consistently across the country, with a particular focus on assessing literacy and numeracy, and we're gathering and disseminating exemplars of good practice. Secondly, in our inspection role, we published Quality and Improvement in Scottish Education last month, a report which draws out trends and highlights some common strengths and weaknesses in the quality of professional practice and provision, looking across all of the areas in which we undertake inspection and evaluation work, ranging from the early years to adult learning. That report clearly illustrates how we use the unique evidence base which we build up through first-hand observation of what's happening in education establishments across the country to provide feedback to practitioners which are designed to feed into their planning for their next steps in the improvement journey. Our staff will be very actively promoting dialogue about how practitioners can best address the improvement themes that the report identifies over the next few months. And I had the pleasure of launching the report in an exemplar of a secondary school that is showing how that can and is being done on the ground. And thirdly, in the first part of the year, we've been developing further our central role in providing professional support for an intensive and highly targeted national improvement programme, the Scottish Attainment Challenge. As the Pupil Equity Fund phase of the challenge was launched, for example, we've been working with policy colleagues to provide a series of conferences which engage directly with almost every head teacher in the country. Our team have provided professional advice to support the design and implementation of the programme, and we're playing a key role in ensuring head teachers are supported to make evidence-based decisions about how they use the funding coming to them. That involves direct support from our attainment advisor team and from other staff, and the development of the Interventions for Equity online resource, which is a pathfinder area for our National Improvement Hub. And the work we are now taking forward with the Education Endowment Foundation to develop a customised Scottish version of their internationally renowned evidence toolkit. So that's just a brief snapshot of 3 dimensions in which we are continuing to strive to apply our role and functions to drive improvement for the benefit of Scottish learners. We'd be very pleased to elaborate further on these developments if the committee so wished, but equally I'm conscious that members will already have other specific issues they want to pursue. And with that in mind, I'll conclude my opening remarks now and say we stand ready to respond to discuss any aspect you want to.
Thank you, explore. Dr. Maxwell. Can I ask you, in your response to the committee, you highlight the recently published Quality and Improvement in Scottish Education 2012 to 2016, which summarises the themes which arose from inspections in that period. In your view, what does this tell us about how well and how consistently CFE is being adopted across the country and what is being achieved?
Yep, thank you. Yes, I mentioned that report I mentioned in my opening remarks. I think how we see that report, as I say, is very much a form of feedback to the system about what's going well and what's going needs more work to improve. It's a mixed picture. We see certainly evidence of some strengths in there. We see increasingly, for example, and this is evidence that comes only really through inspection, of increased motivation and engagement of young people in their learning, more active learning going on in schools across the country. But we've also picked out five key themes where we feel to get fully the full benefits of curriculum for excellence need to be taken further by schools, by local authorities, and certainly with national support. But Alastair oversaw the programme of pulling together the QISI report in his Director of Inspection role and may want to elaborate.
Just to mention about what the basis for the report is, which I think it's important that we understand, is a gathering together of all of our inspection evidence over that period, but also other evaluative activity and other engagements that we have with the system. And it's primarily a professional audience that it's aimed for, because the detail in there is meant to help the professional audience to engage with particular issues of strength and weakness across all sectors and all parts of the education firmament. The five key themes are addressing the situation now, but obviously the evidence that is in this report has been fed into a variety of sources over the course of that period. And what we've done is just then take a stand back at the end and looked for the bigger strategic direction themes that we wanted to put into the system. It's like taking a step back and looking at an overview rather than the continuous feedback that we've provided to relevant bodies, to the system as a whole, during the course of the report.
Okay, there's any other comments? All right, in that case, I'd like to move on to the members and ask Liz Smith to contribute.
Thank you, Convener. Dr. Maxwell, could I ask you about the report that you gave back to the committee following our unanimous report about the evidence that we had heard? In that, you made it very clear that you were addressing our concerns specifically about our issues with the role and the relationship that Education Scotland had with the Scottish Government, and about the implementation and evaluation of CFE. You made it very clear in sections 1 and 3 of the report that you sent back about what should happen. In other words, in section 1 and in section 3 in your report, you state 6 different things that ought to happen. Why did you not address what has happened and the concerns of the committee?
I believe in our response we did aim to address the concerns of the committee and explain what has happened, but if you wish to highlight a specific there where you feel that didn't occur...
Yes, absolutely. If you look at section 1... where it's about the relationship.
We've got 6 bullets there, yeah.
Yeah, you've got 6 bullet points. Now, these are statements of fact about the way in which the relationship should work.
Yeah.
And if you go to section 3, you'll have a similar statement of what ought to happen in the way that Education Scotland interacts about the Curriculum for Excellence.
Yeah.
Could I ask you very specifically, why did you give us statements of fact rather than explain what actually had happened and address the concerns, the very deep-seated concerns which you acknowledged last time you were here on the 30th of November 2016. Why did you not address that?
I believe those statements of fact do reflect what has happened over the course of a period of time in terms of the way the relationship has worked between Education Scotland and government and the CFE Management Board. I think that reflects how it operates.
Can I ask you then, if that's the case... Yep. Are you satisfied, given that some of the recent educational results that we've had are really very disappointing, are you satisfied that that relationship and the way in which Education Scotland has been operating is satisfactory?
I am satisfied that we continue to play a productive, positive role in helping improve the system and through following through the structure that is outlined in the response. And therefore we provide, and I think as we've just described in terms of the QISI report, one of those key roles is to gather evidence from the front line and feed that back in to the management board, to our partners in government, local government, with a view to identifying where improvements are best or most needing to be made, and then work with them to generate activity, such as the work we're doing on the moderation of standards and literacy and numeracy, for example, which will address the areas where there are uncomfortable feedback coming back or evidence of weaknesses. Well, we need to keep doing that. And I don't think it will ever be, everything will be perfectly solved. It will be a constant ongoing process of improvement.
Can I just address that very point, and particularly what you've just said, that you don't think it'll ever be resolved, which I think if I was a parent, I'd be very concerned about. Can I just refer you to some of the very considerable changes that have taken place under Education Scotland? We've seen a huge volume of guidance that over the period of the Curriculum for Excellence has not only changed some of it, in fact, large quantity of it has now been disbanded. We have seen the removal of unit assessments, now reinstated. We've seen the publication of what I thought were very worrying statistics in the Herald last week about the concerns over National 4 and National 5. And in your own report a couple of weeks ago, you raised very considerable concerns about broad general education. Are you not embarrassed about that situation and about the fact that when you reply to what I think was very genuine concerns amongst this committee and unanimous concerns about this committee, all we get is a statement of the facts about how it's supposed to work?
Well, as I say, I'm very happy to describe, and we can maybe describe some more specific actions about contextualising in terms of specific issues which have arisen, which have required action, and where things have not gone as one might have wished from the start. If we could take the tackling bureaucracy agenda as an example of that, for example, where it appeared over a period of time. The management board became aware, we began to see in evidence from inspections, etc., that their assessment overload was occurring to some degree, and we fed that back. It resulted in the management board setting up the assessment national qualifications group. We also then mounted our inspection of the Tackling Bureaucracy Report's recommendations to identify which local authorities were making the most impact on reducing bureaucracy and which were not. We took action as a result of that. Sorry. So it's a process of continuous feedback and improvement which helps address those issues.
Dr. Maxwell, the bottom line here is that parents across Scotland and teachers and indeed pupils see at the moment that we are not doing nearly as well as we should be, and that many of the results, not all of them, but many of the results are not nearly good enough. That's the concern. In our report, we highlighted the fact that we found it very difficult indeed to get to the level where we could understand what decisions had been taken by the Curriculum for Excellence Board and who was responsible for making them. Can you, on the record today, can you explain where you think things have gone wrong in the decision-making process of the Curriculum for Excellence and give some assurance that you are actually addressing them rather than just giving us, this blueprint of how things ought to be working?
Okay. We play our part as a member of the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board. As I think you know, ultimately it's set up by ministers as a vehicle for promoting a collective responsibility and development of decision-making around the issues of policy relating to the development of curriculum for excellence. We play our part in that. We don't take decisions unilaterally any more than other partners within the board do. We contribute.
Are you embarrassed, Dr. Maxwell, about the delivery of the curriculum for excellence?
No, and indeed I would point back to the OECD's assessment, which has described the process of development of curriculum for excellence. It described the management board as being fit for purpose in terms of taking forward a collective commitment across the education system in developing the policy from high-level policy into practice at Curriculum for Excellence. That doesn't mean it will every decision will have been perfectly formed first time, but it's important that board and all the partners at it take collective responsibility for addressing the issues where those and responding vigorously to them where they appear. And we are very keen to see that the board does that.
So can I just finish on the point? You're not embarrassed and you feel that you've done a very good job in the circumstances.
I feel, whilst nothing is perfect, the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board has been a good vehicle for developing Curriculum for Excellence thus far, and there is more work to be done to fully realise the benefits of Curriculum for Excellence. It's a very major reform programme, as I'm sure the committee's well aware.
Can I just before I move on? Well, I'll let Tavish on first, then, and I'll speak after that.
Convener, I mean, I think we take the point about development. I think the criticism that many had was about the implementation of Curriculum for Excellence and the Management Board's ability to do that. But can I just follow Liz Smith's point? Because you, in your opening remarks, you said that Education Scotland would now have the key role. Or I think you used the phrase key role in terms of providing guidance to head teachers to make decisions on the pupil equity fund. Did I get that right? Was that what you said?
We have a key role, yes, a leadership role.
Okay, so how's that been discussed at the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board?
There's a governing mechanism for the Scottish Attainment Challenge.
No, but has it been discussed at the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board?
What the Pupil Equity Fund,
yes,
and the Scottish Attainment Challenge has, yes, indeed.
So Education Scotland are going to play a role in giving guidance to schools, is that correct?
We're in helping schools access appropriate guidance, yes.
What does that
absolutely
mean?
For example, we're the decision-making, and I'm sure you're familiar with Scottish Attainment Challenges, quite deliberately asking head teachers to make decisions that suit the needs of their pupils in the way that they use the equity funding coming to them. But we are very keen they do that on the basis of evidence of what works. And of course, there's no one single solution that every school across Scotland should be using.
Can you tell the committee?
We provide access to that evidence.
Well,
yeah.
And so what is that evidence? How many pages are head teachers now getting of evidence before they're meant to then take an assessment as to what's best for their school?
I think pages is entirely misleading. But we have an online...
What are they getting then? Tell exact what are they getting?
Yep. We have an online resource called the Interventions Equity for Intervention.
Okay. Now, how big is that online resource then?
It's... any individual head teacher will go in and explore an aspect of that resource to find useful, and where it's getting very good feedback on that, I have to say, from head teachers who are looking for guidance. We're also looking, as I mentioned in the opening remarks, we're contracting or seeking to contract with the Education Endowment Fund, which is set up by the Sutton Trust and provides internationally renowned and undoubtedly access to assessment of different interventions that can be used improve performance.
So you're telling the committee there's a range of information that's now available to head teachers. Was that range of information carefully considered by the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board so that there would be a clear understanding across all the agencies, chaired, of course, by a civil servant of the Scottish Government, as to what would be available for head teachers? Was that discussed in detail prior to what you've just described to the committee being available to head teachers?
I say the forum for that discussion primarily has been the governance mechanism for the Scottish Attainment Challenge, which involves local authorities, SOLAS, COSLA, etc. And
there is an advisory committee for that purpose.
Now I'm
totally confused. So it has not been discussed at the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board. It's been discussed at a different board, is that correct? Or a different meeting?
Both are true.
The
Scottish Attainment Challenge has its own governance mechanism, which gives the detailed consideration to how that goes forward.
Okay, but
cross-references are undoubtedly is the Management Board are fully aware of what is happening in the Scottish Attainment Challenge.
What I'm trying to drive at,
but it does not fundamentally.
What I'm trying to drive at is that our previous criticisms as a committee were about the lack of joined-up work between all the different agencies, including your own, so that when information was provided to schools, either to, that had been thought through by all the agencies in whatever forum yep. is appropriate. Has that happened with this?
It has in the appropriate forum, which is the Scottish Attainment Challenge governing
mechanism. Okay, so we can be very clear that if we were to come back to this as a committee, SQA, local authorities, the Education Scotland and all the others know exactly and have agreed exactly what is now being presented to head teachers in terms of the resource to allow them to make decisions over the Pupil Equity Fund.
Indeed, yeah. They have been involved in the governing mechanism for all of these things that is appropriate to the Scottish Attainment Challenge. So local authorities, COSLA, full members of that process.
So we won't get, so therefore teachers will be...
There's also, I should add, an academic advisor that's been appointed to the Scottish Attainment Challenge to ensure the quality of that evidence.
Yeah. So on Liz Smith's point that we won't have the same confusion again that we saw in the past, we can be sure head teachers will be able to come and sit in this chair where you're sitting today and tell us that this resource has been helpful because it's been agreed and understood across all the different agencies and there's no duplication and 1820, this, that, next thing. So that's been sorted out.
And I say we absolutely take the point, which the committee has raised in a few occasions, that it needs to be simple for teachers to get to a one-stop shop fundamentally where you can find good quality evidence.
Okay.
That's absolutely what we're seeking to do.
Thank you.
Okay, Joanne.
Just ask on that point, why would they have? Please explain to me why a head teacher would have to go and get all this evidence themselves. It's not one of the roles of Education Scotland to say this is good practice. You've got this much. The issue is about your choice about what you're going to spend the money on, rather than having to go off and do the research and find new means and processes by which you can deliver on some of these questions.
Yes, sorry, I have not been clear, but that's exactly what we are trying to do, to give head teachers access to an easy one-stop shop online resource, which gives them access. We provide that portal to the head teacher, so they don't have to go hunting around lots of different places for evidence or dig into research journals.
I have to say, I am sceptical about the idea that simply by, parceling off a bit of money and giving it to head teacher within a school, that creates a sense of autonomy and control. Now, I'm sceptical about that, but I would have thought it's more likely to work when the head teacher has the resource and has the ability to access advice about how they can spend that money, not at a one-stop shop, but at the education agency in Scotland. Is that not the education agency's job, to say these things work? We're not going to give you stuff that doesn't work.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm
that is absolutely what we're doing, giving them quality-assured evidence. I say we're very helpful to have the Education Endowment Fund resource, which is very thoroughly tested against evidence for impact. So these are quality-assured interventions that head teachers, we are pointing them to and saying, select from these. There are other things which you should steer clear of.
Without labouring the point, is it not the job of Education Scotland as the education agency in Scotland to identify interventions that work and then work with local authorities and schools to implement them? Is that not their job?
That is what you're saying.
It is exactly. I mean, it is our job, and we take fully that and very seriously that responsibility to provide that guidance that you're asking for there, to hear our quality assured interventions from which you can select to suit your local circumstances, because there is no one single magic bullet that will cure equity, as I'm sure the committee is well aware. But here are, to make head teachers' job much simpler, here are access to some quality-assured interventions from which you can select.
All right. Can I just say that I think that the reality seems to be that what both Joanne and Tavish were looking for, the answers were there, but there seems to be some confusion about what is available. And we talked about clarity. We talked about it the last time. We're getting that again today, where it may well be that all the answers are within there. There's different points that Liz has raised that don't really come under this, but it took forever to get to the point that we could say yes, that information that you're seeking is there, and there should be some clarity about that. We shouldn't have to be asking questions about where the implementation lies. You're talking about it being the attainment fund, the attainment group, right? We shouldn't have to ask that, because that information should be quite readily and easily available. And if we're struggling to figure out where that lies, where the responsibility lies, then how can others do it? You know, we have to make sure that the information is clearer, it's out there, it's transparent for everybody that wants it. Mm-hmm. And also the point that was being made by Joanne there, it's clear that you're doing what education should be doing.
Yeah.
But it took us a long time to get to that.
Yeah, and can I also just add that we're making great efforts to make sure the people who really matter, head teachers, are clear about this, hence the series of conferences that we ran with Scottish Government, which literally gave every head teacher, almost every head teacher in the country, all the ones who are getting pupil equity funding, access to direct face-to-face day with our teams where they were shown exactly what support is there to help them make these decisions, and also to network, because some of it's about collaboration between schools locally.
Okay, just before I move on to Colin, who's got some questions around about school inspections, as do others, just going back to Liz's comments, clearly things are not as bad as the tone was from there, but there was a number of issues that were raised by us that were not satisfactorily responded to, I think we all thought, in the responses from Education Scotland. So there's hopefully we'll get more clarity as the day goes on today. But, Colin.
I wanted to explore some of the issues around this new shorter visit inspection model that you've brought in. First thing, very simple question. On page 8 of your submission of the 17th March, your response, you state, as part of the suite of inspections. So the new shorter visit isn't an across-the-board thing, I would imply from that. Can you maybe explain a little bit more about it?
Yeah, I mean, we have now a suite of a proportionate set of inspection models to suit different circumstances, but Alastair is the best person to elaborate on that.
As part of the review over the last 2 years, we have been in doing a lot of consultation with stakeholders. As a result of that, we agreed that we needed to have a situation where instead of having a single inspection model for schools, for example, we had what we called a suite of models, so different approaches to suit different circumstances, and that allowed us to do different things. So we have a core of a full inspection model, as you would anticipate it being at establishment level. And in addition to that, we have things like the short model, which we've been developing, the neighbourhood model, and the local thematic model, which would form our suite. In addition to that, we have been exploring short notice, which is a different thing entirely, about obviously just turning up under a short notice.
Do you have descriptions of these?
Yep, they're on our website. And we have a special area of our website on the inspection review that's been up and running for that full period where we've explored what these options are. And as we've developed, we revised the full model, and as we finished certain aspects of this review, the full material is then placed available for everybody in the country to have a look at.
I mean, the shorter visit inspection model implies that some things are not going to be done in that inspection. So between a full inspection and the shorter visit, what would or would not be done in that visit?
The full inspection model is looking to cover 5 quality indicator areas, and a shorter model clearly can't achieve that full coverage within its timescale. So for the National Improvement Framework, we are committed to provide a statistically valid sample of schools based against 3 of those 5 quality indicator gradings. And so that requires a certain number of those full inspection models to achieve that. The shorter model allows us to focus on, for example, themes that are arising during a year. So there's a core health check, if we want to put it that way. But it allows us to focus on, for example, emerging themes, so that you could do that for one term, and we could do a series of inspections on a shorter basis. We get around a larger sample. We can find out more quickly and feed back into the system things that it wants to know. So it is more fluid, although what we are looking at as a core of each of those is self-evaluation and self-improvement. Improvement and raising attainment and achievement. So those would be core to whatever inspection model we did.
I mean, obviously you rely on inspections to gather information. What are the implications for the improvement function if you have shorter inspections that don't gather as much information?
It's a balance between getting round a large enough sample so that we have coverage across the country versus a smaller sample looking at it in more depth. But why we approached with the menu, if you like, and those are just two options within the menu, is so that we could get also a broad coverage plus also some more in-depth to back that up in certain areas. And so across the piece, that gives us a better picture, if you like, about how the system is performing.
So your belief is that moving to the shorter inspection model won't compromise in any way your data collection and, you know, implication on from that is the improvement function that you have.
It doesn't compromise the data collection because our statisticians have come up with a statistically valid sample which was peer-reviewed by the Scottish Government Statistical Department to make sure that they were comfortable with that, which then provides evidence through to the National Improvement Framework.
Now, earlier on you referred to talking to stakeholders. Which stakeholders did you involve before making the change?
Yep. Two means of doing that. We have an external reference group that I've mentioned previously that actually meets again next week, and that involves every key stakeholder you can think of, from parents, national parents' bodies, to young people's organisations, to professional associations, local government, COSLA, etc. I mean, it covers the full suite. And that's been really supportive and helpful for us as an agency, because it allows us to get a very quick idea of feedback about how people are reacting to different ideas, and they've helped to guide us going forward. Specifically in terms of consultation on proposals and ideas, we went around and did events across the whole country for teachers and for young people, and we had hundreds and hundreds of teachers attending these. We took workshops in, for example, professional association conferences and ran workshops there to gather information. All that was collated and fed back to this external reference group, as were our proposals for how we take things forward.
Now, obviously, there's been some discussion about the number of inspections you've been doing. And again, in the same document that I referred to previously on page 8, you're talking about being committed to increasing the number of school inspections. Now, obviously, the first thing you think when you see you've brought in a new system of shorter visit inspection models, that it's just a way to get the numbers of inspections up to tick a box.
Yeah, it's not where it came from, and that's genuinely not where it came from. It came from this consultation over the past 2.5 years of this inspection review. There was a feeling that we needed to have more of a mixed approach. And in particular, I would say not the shorter model was the biggest focus of that. It was things like the localised thematic. And I was to look at things from a learner's point of view, not from an establishment's point of view. And maybe we'll come back to that. But to answer your question directly, the biggest issue about increasing inspection numbers is that we lost the number of staff due to retirement and people moving on. And as I said last time at committee, these people came in about the May of last year. It takes about 9 months for them to be fully trained to do their first managing inspector role, which increases numbers. That's when they reach a point where their numbers start to increase. And I was just yesterday in an inspection with one of these new colleagues who was doing their first managing inspector role. So these new staff coming in allows us to increase numbers as well as having a shorter model. But if you think about the complications of planning people, the shorter model is not short enough that would allow us to, for example, increase numbers dramatically.
But you're very much, Colin, I'm going to have to cut you off there. I want to bring Liz back in on this issue, and then Ross got a supplement.
Thank you. Can we just get some clarity about the number of inspections and the number of inspectors? Because if you recall, at the last meeting, there was very considerable doubt as to whether the statistics that we've been provided with were accurate. Can I just be quite clear that the total number of primary plus secondary inspections currently stands at 119 as of the 31st of March. Is that correct?
No. It depends if you include special in that, which we do as schools.
No, the total number of primary and secondary, my understanding from SPICE, and in context with what you said in paragraph, I think it was 204 in your recent statement, am I right? This is 119.
No, it's actually 123, it's within that ballpark. But it's 123 if it's only primary and secondary.
So that was the number that was completed by the 31st of March?
Yes.
Okay. Now, can I ask also, on the 30th of November, you told us that there would be 9 additional inspectors being trained. Are they through that training or not quite yet?
Just right now, as I said, yesterday was the first managing inspector role for one of those, and others have been doing it at different times.
So we've now got 66 plus 9, which is 75, is that correct?
And then we've, for example, we lost 4 in early years over the autumn, and I was just interviewing last week.
So we've got 71.
Those figures. I would have to double check the figures, but it's roughly that, yes.
Okay. Can I just ask for clarity again that the number of inspections, the number of school inspections, since 2012, 2013 has gone down? Number of primary and secondary school inspections has fallen.
Yes, it has, yeah.
Yep. And can I also ask, in terms of the number of inspectors, that number, even if it's 66 plus the 9 eventually, that number has also gone down since 2010?
The number of inspectors overall went down. I don't know the period, but I think we had those
figures according to the statistics that Spice currently updated.
Yeah.
Do you agree with that?
I'm sure that's the case. I don't have the figure in front of me, but I'm sure that's the case. The numbers of inspectors did go down, although now they are increasing again.
Right. I know other colleagues are going to come to this issue about inspection and the dual role, but can I just ask, why is the number of in-school inspections falling?
Well, there's a number of reasons for that. Primarily, we spent a period where inspectors were redeployed from establishment inspection to support the implementation of curriculum for excellence. But you shouldn't take that to mean that they weren't doing evaluative activity, because a lot of what their time was doing was, for example, doing a much larger, shorter scale visits to things like secondary schools to check where they were in terms of redesigning their curriculum in light of curriculum for excellence. So we need to be clear about the distinction about the number of establishments that we inspected versus other evaluative activity that inspectors.
How many of these inspectors who were seconded off to local authorities and wherever to do that very job you've just described, how many of them were not engaged in a full school inspection?
No, they weren't seconded off anywhere. They were working for us. It's just that their deployment...
Well, they were working in local authorities, according to some of the inspectors that I spoke to.
They were working with local authorities, but they weren't seconded to a local authority.
So how many of them were not involved in full school inspection?
No, it's not quite that simple, because it's not about a full-time person being deployed to do that 100% of their time. An inspector's time has actually broken down into a number of days, and there's a number of core days for establishment inspection, and some of that time would have been diverted, but it would have been variable for each individual depending on what the particular issue was. So I can't give you an FTE equivalent.
Is there some way that information would be available for the committee?
It would be very difficult. I mean, it's...
Right. In the view of Education Scotland, given that the comments that have just been made there, do you think that the inspections, be the official inspections or the kind of evaluative inspections that you were talking about there, the number of them dropped, or is there any evidence to suggest that that kind of level of inspection continued to take place?
For me, the overall level of evaluative activity remained relatively unchanged over that period.
Is there any evidence of that?
We would have to try and identify what the scope is of that, because I think we just have to make a distinction. The establishment inspections is what people focus on. How many schools did you visit for a full inspection? It's more difficult when you start to say, so what else classifies as evaluative activity? There was an awful lot of work within other projects. So it would be difficult to say that, you know, if someone was assigned to a project of a piece of work which was evaluating the implementation of the curriculum in secondary, for example, for a period of time, how much of that time was actually spent in schools doing that actual work versus writing up a report or whatever?
Certainly quantify what some of those other activities look like. And, you know, a classic example relatively recently would have been the exercise we undertook to evaluate the tackling bureaucracy activity in each of the 32 local authorities. That was inspectors that undertook that work, HMI. And naturally, it had some knock-on impact on their availability for other work, but it was an intensive, short-term piece of work. And there are other examples, as you say, the fieldwork visits, which were undertaken at key points.
Helpful.
So we can try and quantify
if you could send those sort of examples to us.
Yeah.
Ross, you wanted to come in the supplements.
Yes, thanks. Just on some of Mr. Delaney's remarks in regards to feedback about the inspections. In our committee report, we welcomed that Education Scotland was going to try and tackle some of the misconceptions around it, but we urge you to engage directly with schools. Your response was the media campaign. Was a media campaign the best way to engage directly with frontline staff who have misconceptions?
It is only one aspect of our approach. I mean, we're not trying to say that the media campaign will answer all the misconceptions that people would have about inspection, but it was a good start. The media campaign's been very well received, and the amount of activity, if you like, around about that social media campaign has been very strong. We also, though, engaged with, for example, the professional associations and others so that they could build on that media campaign and push it out through their channels and mechanisms as well. But that's not the end of the picture. We would continually look to do things, for example, by attending a local authority teachers' meetings or whatever, to help them to understand the new processes of inspection. And we do that as a matter of course, but we are doing it more now because of the inspection review and the changes that have been taking place.
Also in your response, you mentioned that you were using GLOW to allow teachers to engage directly with the director on that. Obviously, GLOW is not used consistently by teachers across the board. How are you addressing that to make sure that you're not getting a skewed sample of engagement?
Yeah. Again, it's only one mechanism. I was on a Go TV, as they call it, episode quite recently. There's another one coming up, and that will only cover those who can access, you know, the mechanism through that. But we also, for example, I personally have given presentations at professional association conferences, run workshops. You know, our staff get out and about. The key people, our key lead officers, lead inspectors, get out into local authorities and run sessions on these things so that we can get direct feedback across the country. So this is only one approach that we can take.
Thanks. And just one final point, Convener. What engagement have you had with learners about the inspection programme?
Yeah, we ran, with the help of Young Scott, we ran a range of activity to try to get direct feedback from learners during the inspection process, during the inspection review process. That was really important to us because obviously young people are the end consumer of education, and so we wanted to try to get their views. We also, as a matter of course, through inspections, of course, engaged with young people in focus groups and talked to them about, you know, a whole range of things about how they feel about education, their school, and education more broadly. So we continue to do that. It's a challenge. There is no easy way of saying you can access all of young people. But we are trying hard to achieve, you know, to get young people more directly involved in feedback to us about how they feel about inspection and its role in improvement.
Thank you.
Okay, I'll bring it in later on because there's going to be inspections for Daniel.
Mr. Delaney, you're the Chief Operating Officer of Education Scotland, so that must give you a broad role over all aspects of the day-to-day running of Education Scotland. You must work very closely with Bill Maxwell. Is that correct? How would you describe your role?
Yes, I oversee the running of the internals of the organisation, how the organisation operates, its planning, its finances, its HR, and its obviously future direction.
So, and you're also the Director of Inspections, and in your response to the committee, you describe that the Director of Inspection is distinct and separate from the Chief Executive, and that inspection activity through your governance mechanisms is independent. How on earth can it be distinct and separate while you're also the Chief Operating Officer?
Because the inspection programmes operate through an assistant director who is answerable to me, the complaints process feeds through me. I have a clearly defined responsibility to ensure the independence of inspection and to ensure that that is not in any way impacted upon by any external influence. And so we have a governance set up that allows that to be separately considered.
But you report directly to Bill Maxwell as the Chief Executive.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. So how on earth can that be distinct and separate if you have got that direct reporting relationship? I'm completely confused as to how you can say that.
It's quite clear in our framework document how that operates, but the part of Alastair's job, which is around the Director of Inspection, you could look at it as inspection strategy and compliance, if you like. That is a clear ring-fence area of his role where I don't interfere in. If there are complaints about the inspection process, about some alleged interference in inspection, Alastair deals with that, and I don't get involved in that.
But if he's the Chief Operating Officer, over the vast bulk role, and that's a very senior position, with scope over everything that you do, answering directly to you, surely there are significant consequences if he says no to you. I mean, regardless, I mean, how on earth do you decide what hat you're wearing? I mean, how do you split your heads in two? I just have never come across an organisation that could manage a management structure like that.
I think having a regulatory role embedded within an organisation is perfectly feasible. It's never emerged as an issue, to be honest, because
but you're saying it's distinct. I totally accept that, but you're saying that his role as Chief Inspector, Director of Inspections, is distinct and separate. It strikes me that if he has
with regard to the quality of inspections,
as Chief Operating Officer, that's just a fiction.
No, indeed. It has worked in practice very clearly, and any complaints about inspection process in an individual case would be handled directly through our processes. They're quite clear through Alastair as deciding regularly.
That's a question, and you don't think there's an issue? There hasn't been an issue? So
no, then, right, indeed.
Okay. All right.
So you've obviously had an Education Scotland inspection regime has had a very important role in terms of assessing how curriculum for excellence has been implemented. Can I just ask, judging by your responses to our report, is the inspection regime the sole source of data in terms of the implementation? What other sources are there?
No, and clearly there are statistics. Scottish Government's analytical services team pulled together stats from the SQA and other sources about attainment, for example, about health and well-being, actually, and other aspects of curriculum for excellence, which are equally important. So there is that kind of evidence. There is also, there may be research undertaken independently of government, indeed, by, for example, Mark Priestley, you've probably come across from Stirling University and others. So there are a number of different sources.
So that's Scottish Government's view, but in terms of Education Scotland, what are your sources of information and data points? Is it, and even if it's not exclusive, is the bulk of that from the inspection regime?
Yes, that is the bulk. We don't commission a large research programme, for example. The research programme for Scottish Government's run from Scottish Government, not from ourselves. Occasionally we might commission a small piece of research to about a project we've specifically commissioned, but no, we're not a major research commissioner, so our own evidence that we gather at our own hand is our primary source of first-hand evidence. But of course we also do look at the stats and form a view about trends that are appearing in SQA data and other data in the system.
Through the implementation period, based on your response to us, that you adapted your approach through Curriculum for Excellence implementation to assess that. Is that correct?
Can you elaborate a little on adapt?
I'm just using your words.
We certainly, in terms of, what our inspectors were looking for, clearly, we had, in fact, Alan, you maybe want to elaborate a bit on that.
Yes, each year the evidence coming through inspections and from stakeholders about where the strengths and areas for attention in curriculum corrections would also be discussed at the CFE implementation group with the main stakeholders who are responsible for the delivery. Now, through that, there is a chance to see exactly what's going on and set out some activities that lead on directly from what's happening each year into the following session.
Camina, this is an important point. So you've stated that the inspection regime is independent, but you're also stating very clearly, unequivocally, that the inspection regime was changed and adapted in light of your role in the implementation of curriculum for excellence. I don't understand how these two thoughts are compatible with each other.
Not the inspection regime.
No, I'd actually like Phil Maxwell to answer that point.
Let me be clear. For example, we had agreed collectively across the management board on a rollout programme, effectively, if you like, a six-year rollout of CFE through the secondary stages, which began, I think, in 2010, as the first cohort picked up with new curriculum guidance. It made clear sense that inspectors should respect the expectations that went with the rollout, so we would be expecting to see CFE in S1 initially and then S1, 2, 3, and those changes roll out. So that's what we meant by adapting.
Yeah, so your role in CFE altered evaluation. The approach to inspection. I think you've just said it there.
Yeah,
so
it's and that's reality. There would be no sense in judging by standards 10 years old what we expect in terms of a curriculum now. We clearly have to adapt what we expect. And it's right and proper. Indeed, in many respects, we're raising the bar as we do so.
Right, that's completely understandable. Tavish has got supplementary and then Jordan.
Well, on that line of questioning, do inspectors assess the effectiveness of Education Scotland guidance on schools?
Yes, we do. We pull.
Which bit of view is we in this case?
Our inspectors, as they're out in schools evaluating what they see, will give bring feedback on whether or not that guidance is having the desired impact, or whether it's being effective in its intention.
Yet, in the report that you mentioned in your opening remarks, the Quality and Improvement of Scotland Education 12 to 16, there is no mention of that whatsoever. So they may have assessed it, but they never produced a recommendation?
The feedback we gain from inspections is fed back regularly, both to ourselves and to
the
broader curriculum preference implementation group. And as a result of that, we have taken additional steps at times to emphasise, I suppose a classic example of that would have been last May, the statement I gave, which effectively re-emphasised and clarified guidance which did not appear to be
But Dr. Maxwell, that's not what I asked. Why is there nothing in this, how many pages of a report, that mentions inspectors' findings about the effectiveness of Education Scotland's guidance and its impact on schools? And there's no recommendation in relation to that subject whatsoever.
That report is written for a practitioner audience, and it provides
practitioners would care about this, wouldn't they?
Absolutely, and we have mechanisms for discussing where there's a need for additional guidance or indeed reduced and streamlined guidance, as we have done.
So Daniel Johnson's point is quite correct. There's a clear conflict of interest, and the fact you can't even make a recommendation about that guidance based on the inspector's own findings illustrates that, doesn't it?
No, I don't accept that at all. Okay. We will.
All right, thank you.
Yeah. We're going to move on to Joanne now. This isn't the only organisation that we're... people wear two hats, if you like. So, I mean, we shouldn't pretend that this is unique for Education Scotland. So, that's why we're here, but we shouldn't pretend that it's the only place in the world that this sort of thing happens. Joanne?
I mean, I do think there's an issue about the notion of collective responsibility can often mean that nobody's responsible, nobody's accountable, and I think that's one of the frustrations. But I'm interested in... I mean, I understand you have to make this organisation work because it's government policy that Education Scotland should have both responsibilities. I get that. That doesn't mean you have to say it is the optimal model, it's the best model in terms of how we deal with our education system. But can I just clarify? You've accepted that there are fewer inspections and there are fewer inspectors since, I think, 2012. Is that right? You've also said... I find it astonishing that one of the things that you did say was that inspectors have been redeployed, but it's okay because they're doing evaluation work, and it transpires that evaluation work is evaluating the mess that's been made around the bureaucracy, around curriculum for excellence. So the inspectorate bit of Education Scotland is assessing that in curriculum for excellence terms, how poorly it has been delivered in terms of guidance. That job would not be seen as a normal job for inspectors, surely, would it? I understand you redefining it as evaluation, but would you accept it's not what you would see as a normal role for an inspector?
I wouldn't accept that, because I think it's absolutely normal that we use inspectors to assess extent to which consistent good practice is applying at a local level across the local authorities, across the schools in the country. That's partly the benefit of having a national inspectorate which looks across those boundaries.
Well, with respect, that wasn't what was described. It was described as people who were redeployed to evaluate and write a report on tackling bureaucracy, staff could have told you from day 10 probably that there was an issue with. And I wonder whether... that redeployment, I mean, perhaps I can ask Alastair this, that redeployment would have happened if it had been a separate body. Would a separate body that was responsible for inspections, given that curriculum for excellence happened, would have redeployed people out of its organisation to assess the scale of a problem?
Yeah, I think, again, it's this use of the word redeployed. It's actually deployed. In other words, we nobody came out of the organisation. It was just a task that we were asked to do.
But by having done a task... Normally, if the inspectorate was a separate body, would it have been a task for an inspectorate to write a report on the accumulation of bureaucratic guidance to staff in implementing a new curriculum?
I don't see it any different than asking, for example, in years to come, the impact of the PEF money or any other initiative or thing which is going on in the system which could be a barrier to good effective learning and teaching and good outcomes for learners. So we would be interested in anything like that.
But inspectorates hadn't really thrown up this issue until staff had flagged up. Anyway, I suppose my last point, I mean, I appreciate from the Queen's point of view, there's a lot of things to be grown. The first point I made was, you don't have any choice but to make this work. But can you cite any evidence from any external organisation other than the Scottish Government who advocated that it made sense to bring together an organisation which is developing policy alongside the organisation that's then inspecting its impact? Which external organisation? We know from our own evidence that academics have expressed grave concerns about it. I wonder if you can cite people who, before the government decided to do it, were advocating this position.
Can I start by clarifying that we don't set policy. What we do is we support the implementation of agreed policy and inspect and evaluate around that. Can I also clarify that this is not particularly new? And if the 5 to 14 reforms, some of us will remember, or HM Inspectorate of Schools at that time led the reform process very directly. They undertook examples of activity very much as we have done recently around looking at how well it's implemented.
Process. It wasn't developing policy, it was firefighting.
No, it was looking at the effectiveness of steps that local authority, and some local authorities have taken very good steps around how to reduce the load that they were requiring in terms of planning and reporting to parents and all of that, and circulating good practice from that, which we have done since that time, and we will follow up on that again. But that is absolutely, that would have been, I am absolutely convinced, the same under a separate inspectorate would have been doing that kind of activity and did do in the past, as required by the development of our current initiative.
So one organisation, individual, academic, ahead of this organisation, performed in the way it has been, argued that it would be beneficial to have the Agency for Education Scotland being in the same body as the inspection board. I mean, apart from the Scottish Government, was there anybody that you know of who argued for this model?
If you don't,
I can't name anyone, no. I'm not right. Suggesting that there's a name I could put to who right, that, suggested that specifically, no.
That's fine, thank you. You've answered the question, and we'll just leave it there. Ross?
Dr. Maxwell, I understand that you've been the chief executive of the CFE implementation group since it was created in 2011. Is that correct? Yes, yes. I noticed in the recent report that's been quoted, the Quality and Improvement in Scottish Education 2012-2016 report, that it was noted, and I'll quote from it, that Scottish education does not yet provide all children and young people with consistently high quality learning experiences. Unless this variability is addressed, we will not achieve the national ambition of excellence and equity for all learners. Dr. Maxwell, could you explain to the committee why, during this inspection period, which has clearly been under your own stewardship, we still do not see consistency across the board?
Yeah, that's, of course, a big question, and we will continue to promote consistency. We have a devolved system of the management of education, where local authorities run schools, and schools have a degree of autonomy themselves. The answer to that lies in consistently identifying, flagging up, and disseminating the most effective practice and encouraging others to adopt it and removing any obstacles that get in the way of them doing so. But education systems, and I'm sure you'd accept as a fair point, are in constant improvement. None can stand still or ever reach a state of perfection is probably not something we'd be realistically suggesting we're about to have. So, but greater consistency and spread of best practice is the key to achieving the world-class status we're looking for.
Okay. In the same report, it was highlighted that 42% of ELC settings, 40% of primary schools, and 43% of special schools that were inspected haven't implemented the CFE beyond a satisfactory level. Moreover, it was noted, and again I'll quote from the report, that colleges have made some progress with implementation of curriculum for excellence. There is more to be done. We're now 5 years on from the inception of the implementation group, and the CFE is far from being implemented properly. Why is that?
These are big structural changes. If I pick up the college aspect, and college we might talk, one of the themes that we highlight in our QISI report is around greater networking between schools and local colleges and other training providers to deliver effective, a full range of senior phase provision. That's been helped, I think, to some degree by college regionalisation reforms. That's been helped by changes to senior phase reforms, but there is some very good practice out there in some areas, but we need to see that spread much more widely so that young people really are accessing an integrated offer from across the schools and local college and training provision in their areas. I don't know if there's anything more you want to say about that.
Change in education takes some significant time in there, and whilst we're seeing a lot of change happening, and the QISI report points out to these changes in terms of the ways that the schools are organising their curriculum, improving learning and teaching, to actually deeply embed that in the way they're talking about in terms of the big aspirations for curriculum for excellence, that does take time to filter right across every single school. I think what the QISI report is doing is stepping back and looking at where the system is compared to where we think it should be. And as Dr. Maxwell Bill pointed out there are a lot of strengths, but it's beginning to hone down on what the next areas are to really specifically focus on that will turn that tide, tip the balance, and put us really into the benefits that CFE is looking for.
Of course, I can. I'm the convener. Given when we started and where we are now, would you say that this is... that you're behind schedule, you're on schedule, you're ahead of schedule? Because you're right, it does take a long time to change education. But, you know, where are we in the process?
Reducing a very, very large evaluation to a fairly simple conclusion. But
you must
I think
some,
I would
there,
agree...
There must have been some idea of what the journey was going to be like, and I know that you couldn't do it. You know, smoothly, but...
Yeah, and I think, I agree, and again, almost with the OECD's evaluation that we've been through a period which has been characterised by a lot of structural change for everyone in the system to get used to, and that has made progress, it has changed things, but we're now entering a new phase, well, we're in a new phase now, where really driving out the benefits of those changes and ensuring that schools, colleges, whoever, who have only half-heartedly, and there are some adapted to the new curriculum for excellence opportunities, really grasp them going forward, how we, the issue for the whole system and for us as part of that undoubtedly, how to promote and make sure that best practice gets really embedded and spread across the system. So the job is certainly not done yet.
So you would be confident then that if Education Scotland, and I know it won't be you because of your impending retirement, Dr. Maxwell, but were in front of us in a year's time or 2 years' time, that the corner would have noticeably have been turned?
Yes, I think so.
Right, okay. Let Liz in first. Now
sure.
It's a very, very simple question. The Cabinet Secretary said in the Chamber in December that he was considering the reform of agencies, including Education Scotland, as part of the governance review. Do you think that is a good thing, and what would your reform structure look like?
It wouldn't be for me to comment on what the outcome of that should be, but I do think it's a good thing to a governance review, such as the government are undertaking at the moment, ought to look at all parts of the system and how they interact together. So it makes perfect sense that Education Scotland should be part of that, as the other national bodies and also local authorities. I think a key issue, though, if I can be maybe a little more helpful for in terms of the governance review for the role of the agency, will be how the role of the agency interacts with regional working, because it's something we're also keen to promote across local authority boundaries. There's work we're doing at the moment, for example, with the Tayside Group, if you like, Angus, President Kinross and Dundee, and the Northern Alliance you've probably heard of. So looking at how we adjust what we do, if Education Scotland is continuing this form, to best lever our national role with regional capacity, which we do think needs improved in the system, at the kind of role that local authorities can play in supporting improvement and challenging progress in their own areas, probably better done in the future, I think, through regional arrangements than individual local authorities all trying to do it separately. So that's a...
Back to Ross. Yeah.
Thank you, Convener. Dr. Maxwell, in a submission to this committee on the 30th of November, where guidance from Education Scotland was being looked at, teachers were asked by the committee, does the guidance and support associated with CFE build a world-class curriculum for all learners in Scotland? Now, a huge two-thirds of the respondents disagreed with that statement. Now, combine this with the findings within the Quality and Improvement in Scottish Education report, is it not fair to suggest that the implementation of CFE through the current structure of the implementation group just hasn't been effective?
I think the structure has got us to the point where we need to now move forward, and it will require different activities going forward to fully embed the changes, the structural changes that have been made. The implementation group had a particular role, I should say, and it was really created to coordinate between SQA, ourselves, College Development Network, and some other bodies who were providing key aspects of the national support to support the transition, particularly as qualifications, new qualifications work through the senior phase, the broad general education and senior phase years. That's now moving forward. We're now moving, the structural changes in many respects are being made, although there are still clearly refinements being made, as was mentioned earlier, around the national qualifications, with SQA particularly leading on that. That implementation group was created to make absolutely sure, and apart from the group meeting, actually, we have senior accountable officers within each of the organisations who meet monthly to make sure we are joined up on the support and guidance that goes on around delivering those changes to the system. But we're getting beyond the structural change phase of CFE, I think, now to where it's down to practice and provision at frontline level that needs to be continuously enhanced and spread, the best practice spread across the system, as I say.
Last question, Ross.
Yeah, it is. Thank you, Convener. I look back to the inception of the implementation group in 2011, and before this committee in September, the 20th of September 2011, Mr. Maxwell, you said, my vision is of an education system that is based on a strong national consensus about the purposes of education and the commitment to ambitious levels of achievement for all, and which is world-class in its ability to improve continuously and almost virally, spread ideas about the most effective professional practice in ways that ensure that every learner gets the best quality experience suited to their individual needs. Dr. Maxwell, do you think that vision has been achieved? And if not, why not?
One thing I can should start by saying is I do think there is still a very broad buy-in to where that quote started from, the overall purposes and the broad vision for what we want in Scotland from our education system. And I do think that's partly because there was such a thorough process gone through early on in the life of the Parliament, really in 1990 through to 2004, to the national debate around purposes of education and all of that. So I do sense that, and I think, you know, the Parliament's played a strong role in that. It has, whilst there are differences about aspects of implementation, and no doubt not everything has been got right perfectly at every step of that process, nonetheless, the vision remains constant, and the general buy-in across stakeholders in the system is strong. So I do believe that we're well placed to continue to progress, to achieve the ambition, albeit we do all need to be constantly alert to making sure the real intentions of the changes are actually realised in practice, and that's for us and for all partners in the process. But the collective consensus behind the development of Curriculum for Excellence has been a powerful and I think widely recognised beyond Scotland feature of the way this has developed.
Okay, thank you. Daniel, you've got a small, short...
I'll try to make it small. In your response to Ross Thompson, you talk about world-class status, about constant improvement. Indeed, Education Scotland is described by yourselves as the National Improvement Agency for Education Scotland. So would you describe the PISA results, which showed that we've gone from 10th, 11th and 11th for science, maths and reading in 2006 to 19th, 24th and 23rd? Is that improvement or is it something else?
The PISA results are disappointing. Put statistically, certainly we moved from being above the OECD average in two areas out of three to average on three. So that's not acceptable going forward. And hence it's partly why we're putting a great deal of effort into supporting the system around understanding standards and literacy and numeracy, which is what PISA tends to major on, but they're important skills for across the curriculum. So that needs to improve. That's an ad. Of course, there are many statistics in the world, and we also have stats showing that more young people are achieving hires than ever. The rising trends in hires and positive destinations post-school are at a record high, in fact. So there's a range of stats to take into account. Those were disappointing ones.
So on international stats, we don't see improvement. It's only on our internal ones that we do.
Our internal ones are very important, and the international ones are only a snapshot of certain aspects of skill at a certain age, but that's not to undermine the fact that they are the only kind of benchmark we're involved in where we can compare with other countries across the world.
That's an interesting contrast with your own data.
Yeah.
Okay. Joanne?
I mean, I hear what you say around statistics, and it does frankly sound rather defensive, but I wonder if you had reflected on, we heard from the IPPR last week, talking about this issue of positive destinations being seen as a good statistic when it doesn't define what a good positive destination is, doesn't define what a good quality training or education opportunity is. And I wonder, are you planning to do any work on actually backing up? I mean, simply to say a positive destination is a job, if that job, and we've said this before, is a 0 hours contract with no guarantees, no training, and no progression, is hardly a positive destination. And I wonder if you have reflected on the PPR report on this particular question around positive destinations.
Yeah, and it's really for other agencies, I think, to dig more deeply into what the definition of positive destinations. So I'm aware they are, you can break them down into higher education, further education, employment, training, etc. And there are trends on the ones I think we'd all accept are probably very clearly positive destinations, like higher education, including some evidence that the equity gap has been shifting in a positive direction, although we've got a good way to go to get fully through that.
You cited the issue of positive destinations as a rebuttal against an argument that international may appear to be doing poorly. You're now saying that you think that some positive destinations are positive and some aren't. I mean, I don't know whether it's something
I wouldn't
you want
comment
to reflect on further and perhaps give the committee more information on the work you're doing in this, so that we're not simply accumulating the fact that people are going into jobs as being a defence against suggestions that the standards are slipping. If you're saying there are some positive destinations which are more positive than others, it would be good to see your workings in that regard.
Can I ask Dr. Maxwell, is it the responsibility of Education Scotland to decide what's a positive destination?
No, that's... I imagine government statisticians working with Skills Development Scotland.
With respect, then, you ought not to be using it as a defence against an argument in international standards. We've got a problem.
We don't run it any more than we run PISA or many of the other sources of data. But
if you've been asked to reflect on data and you use another set of data to argue against it, you can't then say, but it's not our job to define what a positive destination is, if you present it as a positive argument against what's been presented in terms of international...
Can I say, if I was to flip that statistic, the opposite of a positive destination in current terms is being out of a job and out of training and out of education. In the old days, there used to be a term which I... around not in education, employment or training. That has reduced, and I think that has to be a good thing. I mean, I wouldn't...
Okay. Right. Thank you for that. Is there any other questions before we finish off this session? If not, then can I thank Dr. Maxwell,
Mr. Armstrong, Mr. Delaney for their attendance today. And in case we don't see you before you retire,
before the end of June,
wish you well for the future and whatever you decide to do. But I think there may be a possibility that you'll be back sometime before you leave.
No one. Thank you very much. I look forward to that.
Lucky man. Thank you very much. Thank
Great.
You.
Thanks.
And we now bring to the end the public part of the meeting. Thank you.